Our next presenter is Gabriel Alvarez from the Universidad Politécnica de Catalunya. As you can see from this slide here, he is a full-time staff at the university in the computer science department and since 2003. Previously worked as a senior IT consultant for innovation and database processes. I don't know if we have him on yet. Oh, there he is.
Okay. The
presentation is ready to go. So
full screen, one moment, please.
Ready to go.
Okay.
We see you on the screen and we are good to go.
Okay, thank you. Good morning and greetings from Barcelona. I would like to thank the OpenSFS and the University of Florida for this opportunity. My name is Gabriel from the UPC University, and we would like to share with you our experience using Luster as a general purpose file system. We have a tight schedule, so let's begin. First thing first, now just a really quick overview about us to set a context of this proposal in order to understand who we are and what we do. The Research and Development Lab was founded in 2010 at the Computer Science Department to foster research group projects. That means we provide support for different knowledge areas such as artificial intelligence, natural language processing, big data, or computer graphics. Currently, we are working with 18 research groups from the UPC and other fellow European universities, and also research centers, managing high-performance computing and cloud resources. All our services rely completely and happily in a Luster storage system using the 2.12 branch, along with the CFS support. Okay, enough about us. Every research group has its specific projects, and every project has its specific needs. On one hand, every project has its own funding resources. Some are well estimated and belong to several million euro projects, but most are not. Even more, some initiatives could be just a prototype or a crazy idea from a researcher without any official funding that maybe will become a real proposal or even a spin-off. For this reason, a static one-size-fits-all storage policy won't fit for us. On the other hand, research is an alive creature that grows and evolves along the time. You can design a perfect storage at your proposal stage, but when the time comes, you have to face reality. Researchers will ask for new environment and services because they need to try and test frequently. Therefore, it would be a great idea to have a storage environment that lets you do the same. Luster, as you already know, is a solid project with a very active community. It has been very successful in specific silos, like, for example, HPC, but surprisingly is not commonly used in general purpose applications such as databases or cloud services. We have a good degree of expertise playing with the Luster architecture, so the obvious choice was to vouch for Luster as our main general store file system. And as we always do, we made some experiments and share ideas with other fellow IT services as a way to learn new points of view. Most people like this concept, but at the end, they didn't dare to step up. After some deep discussions, we found out that usually misconceptions about Luster were at the bottom of their reluctance. For example, any Luster setup must be expensive. The Luster architecture is difficult to understand, or concerns about the compatibility with their existing hardware. But the number one was always, who's using Luster as a general purpose file system? What are the how-tos and the documentations that explain successful stories? And this is what this presentation is about. We learn a lot about Luster and being able to use it in our services because other people collaborating, writing new code, keeping the Wikipedia up to date and providing support for this project. With the same collaborative spirit, we would like to share our proposal with all of you, adding a small contribution to the Luster community. This is not something we invented by ourselves out of the blue. It's a guide for helping you walk off the beaten track, avoiding our mistakes and taking advantage of our experience. We offer you a receipt, a triad-based architecture for a multi-purpose file system. So it's up to you how to customize it, or if you want, how to cook it. The classical cluster setup is usually grouped into very familiar layouts. I won't go into details because most of you already know better than me how this works. But please, feel free to ask at the end of this presentation or send us an email anytime. Type A is the most common layout for a quick cluster deployment. A single OSS is used to serve one or more OST directly attached to a disk pool or a JBOD, usually with a RAID 5, 6, or 50, 60 setup. This type does not provide any kind of high availability service. Type B, on the contrary, deploys two OSS connected to all existing OSTs in order to offer high availability and better performance, splitting the client request. If one OSS is not available, its pair takes full control and restores the service. This is our starting point. So now let's go to the kitchen. We want to provide an adaptive and competitive architecture to offer all kinds of services, not just HPC, but we want to keep the essence. Do it with Cluster. Zooming out is like most modern chefs do with the new cuisine. They start with a popular and very recognized dish and change it through creativity and innovation, keeping the essence. Well, we are engineers, so for our approach, we will use the scientific method. Well, sort of. We have to identify all existing ingredients, set a clear goal, cluster for all type of services, and define the existing constraints. Compatibility, easy to deploy, totally customizable, and we must also define a baseline and a frame for our proposal to ensure our requirements and decide which way to go. And last, but not least, have fun and play. We have to combine everything, test crazy idea, benchmark results, and the most important, taste it. When you are cooking, you must taste your own food. That means for us, build prototypes and run them in a supervised environment, usually on our own services, but usually non-critical. Synthetic benchmark can mislead you because real user behavior cannot be modeled. If your prototype suits you, I mean tastes good for you, could, and I stress could, deliver to others. But if your proposal doesn't taste good for you, for sure won't do for others. Okay, let's now see how long took this process for us. This idea was initially discussed in 2015 between our IT engineers. In the following years, we were building several prototypes, doing some research, and talking about with other university staff. In 2018, Cluster Branch 2.10 improves the CFS performance for data and metadata, providing a fairly good performance compared with LDiskFS. So we add the CFS to our ingredient list and began to tinker with it. In a few months, we developed a successful tire-based prototype that fulfilled our requirements. In 2019, we began to deploy this new scheme in our main storage system. After several months, a 400 terabyte cluster system using a CFS triad architecture was successfully used in the research and development lab. And today, in 2021, we are sharing our experiences with you at the Cluster User Group Conference, and we hope you find it useful. The man in the picture is Mr. Ferran Adrià, one of our most famous chefs worldwide. His innovation and creative approach have changed the haute cuisine, high cooking. He has many interesting speeches and books explaining his processes and ideas. I absolutely recommend all of them. And in my humble opinion, there's a clear correspondence between his mindset and the engineering design process. So we try to borrow some of his thoughts to spice our engineering methodology. In this way, this is our triad-based architecture for Cluster Recipe. By the way, his t-shirt says proceso creativo, that means creative process. Okay then, first thing first, one more time. The main ingredients for this layout are three physical servers. You can choose whatever model or vendor you like. In our example, we have mixed a Supermicro model with an HP and a Dell server. You can mix, if you want, different types of disk on every server. For example, for SATA drives, for solid state disk and for non-volatile memory NVMe cards. The only mandatory feature is that each server provides the same kind of this technology layout because we have to gather the disk. Secondly, we must build a dedicated network between our Triad servers that offers a proper performance and stability. Keep in mind that this network will limit the overall performance of the Triad, so keep a balance between the number of disks in every server and their technology type. Usually, the most important point for this network is the latency, because the Triad volume must behave as a one disk pool. So an InfiniBand or equal network must be used. We agree also that bandwidth is important, but in most environments, the input-output patterns do not require full performance of every disk 24/7. For example, most systems take advantage of RAM caches, limiting the effective access to physical disk. However, all the volume sync operations must be executed immediately through all its members to enforce data integrity. And this is an absolutely critical issue because we must guarantee reliability under any circumstance. A point-to-point network connection will avoid hardware issues such as single point of failure or network congestion delays. After all, these physical servers are connected together. Now we must share all these devices among the Triad members. The transport overhead is very important for latency issues. So a nice and compliant way of doing this is using the ICER, the iSCSI extensions for RDMA. This way, you can see the Triad as a whole, regardless of the underlying architecture. In our experience, as a rule of thumb, this dedicated network must be good enough to keep the overall performance. Therefore, at least the remote disk access and the input-output achievement must be over 90% of the local disk access time and performance, megabytes per second. You can do some benchmark to compare the achieved performance and tune network parameters if needed. And finally, we can assemble this CFS mirror using one disk from every physical server. The CFS itself ensures data integrity and an efficient read and write access, avoiding extra layers like logical volume managers, LVM, multiple disk and device administration, Linux MDADM, or array controller dependencies. We won't dig into CFS details because it will be too long, but as you will see, choose CFS is by far the right choice for this Triad-based system. CFS is fully supported in Luster and it's mature enough to use it in production environments. And unlike other file systems, provides a built-in data checksum CRC. So using multiple data copies will help you keep your data in good health. Moreover, having a 3-disk CFS mirror will help us to resolve a tie break in case of data corruption. Another interesting feature is the disk recovery procedure. In contrast to Linux multiple disk, MDADM, or most array controllers, CFS is clever enough to copy only the effective used data, limiting the rebuild stress. We use a 3-disk mirror setup because for more sensitive data, 2 copies could not be enough, whereas 4 copies are too expensive for large storage systems. But as you can see, you can add extra reliability for your data just appending more disk to the mirror group. At this time, we have a functional Triad setup that could be directly used in a simple Luster setup. But we want to go beyond. We need to provide a competitive setup that lets us use Luster as a general purpose file system. So let's go back to the kitchen and spice our Triad. We already have a preparation with several CFS mirrors scattered over the table. For this reason, we will group them in 3 different CFS stripes. Every stripe will eventually become an OST, OST0, OST1, and OST2. That would be served through a physical server in an active high availability setup. It's important to underline that disk and storage devices, regardless of the technology, will increase their capacity every year. This is the slide that is after we go to the kitchen again. It's important to underline that disk and storage devices, regardless of the technology, will increase the capacity every year. Large disk configurations in a group like Common JBOD or vendor array setups using 12, 24, 48 disks over write 5, 6, 50, 60 plus spare will increase the failure likelihood of another disk while rebuilds are in progress due the long time required and the big amount of system stress. In our trial proposal, any failure is local to its CFS mirror group and has a very limited impact in their OST. Moreover, this setup can also use the Luster file stripping over OST feature if big file support is required. As you can see, it's possible to merge in the same page drive different mirror types. For example, one CFS mirror using 4 terabyte SATA along with another CFS mirror using 1 terabyte SATA disk. In this case, both mirrors are based on spinning SATA technology, so you have a fair performance. Of course, you will get maximum performance with same disk or equals, but we absolutely discourage grouping in the same OST different technologies because it's like a stagecoach. The slowest horse set the overall pace. For example, a CFS mirror using SATA spinning disk along with a CFS mirror using SATA solid state disk must be avoided because seek times are totally different and you get an inconsistent performance. In order to have a good response of your triage setup, we need to enforce a coherent stripe policy. As a rule of thumb, you can run a performance test over every CFS mirror and compare their seek and access time and also their random and linear performance. As long as their results differ less than 10, maximum 15%, are suitable for grouping together. At this point, we have 3 balanced OST that will be served through the 3 available OSS. So we can use any resource management software, for example, the well-known Corosync, to spread out the volumes and provide high availability. This trial architecture is very convenient for the quorum sake because using only 2 physical servers could lead to a deadlock in certain situations. With an odd number, we can break the tie easily. In addition, we can take advantage of the high availability service thanks to the CFS pool cache feature to increase the overall output of the system using a high-speed device or even a RAM disk. It's important to stress currently only the synchronous writes are cached. Therefore, we strongly recommend to use a read-only cache configuration. You can also tune your CFS pool with very useful options like transparent compression, different block sizes, and so on. But you must be compliant and ensure the Luster CFS compatibility attributes. Please check the wiki documentation to prevent any problem. Okay, then let's now present the dish to the customer. This diagram, a little bit simplified, is how our triad-based storage system looks like. We have a single Luster space where every service has a home directory enclosed in a several dedicated OST. For security reasons, every client only mounts the specific slice of Luster needed for its service, forbidding the access to other data. One of the biggest benefits of sharing the same space across a single Luster service is the flexibility to move data between different OSTs if needed. For example, when a service is only a proposal, could use borrowed space or a scratch zone, and when the funding is granted, this data must be relocated to its new triad home OST. Or just when you are running out of space in a service, which is the more common use. Another interesting Luster feature is the PCC, Persistent Client Cache, available in the 2.13 branch that could deliver amazing performance in specific services that exclusively need access to a single file. For example, a database file or a virtual machine image are not written by different clients at the same time, so can take advantage of this feature. Truth be told, we have also a secondary Elastic storage for backup and scratch purposes. We have some ecological concerns, so we try to use Triad service as much as we can. Okay, now let's go to the conclusions. As I said before, in the beginning of this presentation, this is not a magic idea coming out of the blue, not an overnight success. It's an evolution of previously contributions to the Elastic project and the result of many experiments and informal chats with fellow IT staff. This way, our presentation today just wants to contribute to the Elastic community, offering a new guide or a recipe to extend the Elastic usage from its present consolidated environment to the unexplored land of generic services. So to encourage this transition, let's talk about some of the benefits of this proposal. It provides a high degree of customization. Our triad-based layout can be easily integrated into any existing Elastic storage system. You can build high-performance backends as well as not too expensive scratch zone, or even reuse all hardware for backup purposes. Just choose sweet or salty flavor. Base it on your current needs and just cook it in your kitchen lab at your own taste. Performance is granted in two ways. At OST level, the CFS stripe spread user request among several Triad CFS mirrors, making the most of your disk devices. At OSS level, three physical servers share the input-output network load using an active-active-active configuration that also provides high availability. This proposal, in addition, offers a good balance of your storage investment. Two data copies could not be enough for most environments, whereas four copies could be too expensive for large deployment. Keep in mind that you can have a different redundancy level in every OST. Instead of building only three disk CFS mirrors, you can also create four disk mirrors or six disk mirrors, and so on. On the other hand, unlike classical multiple disk, like 5, 6, 50, 60 configurations with several dead spare disk, now all disks are truly working always, providing performance for read and no penalty for writes because they are all processed in parallel. And about the reliability of this system is always granted by the CFS itself. We don't use any intermediate layers between the physical devices and the logical Triad layout. We trust absolutely in the built-in capabilities of CFS, data checksum CRC, and the self-healing scrub service. This way, using an odd number of disks will help to break the tie if needed. Another good feature about this proposal is the isolation of its ingredients. In case of a disk failure, only the CFS mirror is affected, not even the whole OST. Besides, CFS only copies the real used data, avoiding the high stress generated in large RAID volumes. As we said before, this is a very important issue when dealing with big disks. For example, the rebuild time using 12, 18, or 20 terabyte disk increases dramatically the likelihood of another failure due to the high generated stress. And of course, in Elastic, size matters. As a general purpose file system, we must provide support for any kind of service and file size. The OST stripping feature allows this directly. And last but not least, the multiple benefits that CFS provide would make the most of all your hardware. We are running out of time, and I won't go into the CFS details, but keep in mind that you can use CFS features like simple cache, transparent compression, the duplication, and different block sizes, and so on. This year is the UPC anniversary. We are 50 years old. And this is the official commemoration picture that says in Catalan, our regional language, 50 anys sense limits, 50 years without limits. And I think it would be a good motto for these presentations, make a small contribution to the Luster community, expanding their usage with no limits. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Gabriel. We have a number of questions that have popped up. First one that we have here is there any performance gains using special and cache drives when combining small files with metadata?
Well, I'm taking a look at that. I will try to answer questions last one first, okay?
All right.
How was EFS is to use? Really easy. It's very easy to make the deployment because CFS uses the devices that iCert provides. So it's just a local device. No problem with that because all machines, all servers can access to all devices. So it's like a local, no problem. The OSTM is switched between devices, but only mount on one. Yeah, but CFS, one of the properties of the CFS Luster, I was saying that Luster also need some CFS properties. And one of the properties is this, that which server has mount this CFS volume. So you cannot mount a volume in a different server if was previously used in another server. You have to force this. So you have some kind of a shield in order to don't destroy your own data. Active-active means both sides of a failover pair. I when I use active-active, it's because all disks are working and they are served through the three physical servers at the same time. So, I mean, you have three OSTs and you have three OSS and all of them are working all the time. You can split your request user or the client request in every OSS server, but all the disk also provide support. There is no spare disk, there is no master slave. You can use a passive if you want only when one OSS is down. Then another one with the high availability server must take control of the OST and brought it online. But in any case that everything is working, you have always an active. I hear active is more than one. Yes, three OSTs. We try to assemble all the CFS mirrors in three OSTs, OST 0, 1, and 2. So you can serve three OSTs at the same time. I don't think there's more questions. This can be done with this can be done with HA active. Yes, as I said, CFS volumes in general, but in Luster, have a property that says who was the server that was using this volume. So when everything is working right and you have three OSTs and you have three OSS, okay, everyone has its own mirror. The high availability coroutine provides this. And if there is a problem and you try to mount or remount this CFS volume, you will have an error because it will say for a property, this CFS volume is already mounted or was mounted in this server. So you have to force to do that. I mean, it's impossible to do that accidentally because you have to force the mounting of a volume if it wasn't mounted in your own server. I've tried the fabric or similar idea. Did I share Dubeta? Well, the key for using iCert or whatever you want is the network. It's not the same. For example, if you use an InfiniBand Connect X2, 40 gigabytes, or if you use a Connect X5, 100 gigabytes. You must use a current technology that can provide a very good latency for all the servers. For example, you have only six disks in a server, that's no problem. But for example, if you have 48 disks in a server, you need a very, very, very high technology to share all the disks through three physical servers. That's a point. The point is that you need a network good enough that provides performance for all the disks you have. So you have to balance how many disks you want to use in a triad and which kind of disk. For example, if they're using SATA spinning disk, you don't have a strong requirement for that. But if you're using NVM or SSD solid state disk, you need more performance and also a lower latency. When using point-to-point connection, yes, we use point-to-point connection because for two reasons. The main one is to avoid single point of failure. I mean, if you have a connection to a switch, this switch is also a point of failure. And the second one is for latency. When you are sharing your devices, your local disk, you're creating a CFS volume. So this volume, you must think about like a single disk. So every writing operations must be executed at the same time for reliability. Imagine that you are writing on one disk and one server, shut down one server. What happens with the disk? You must be ensured that every disk has the same copy of the data, and CFS provides that. And for have a reliable and have a good performance, you need a point-to-point connection between, because for example, if you have a switch that is also shared with other InfiniBand networks or whatever, you can have also congestion delays. With a point-to-point, there's no congestion. There's a straight connection between the servers.
All right, Gabriel, thank you very much. We're strapped for time here and we need to move on.